What are the kind of figures that actually
look? It is quite alarming. Actually, dengue fever is caused by an arbovirus, and this arbovirus is basically a single-stranded RNA virus. So I must tell you, there are four serotypes: 1, 2, 3, and 4. Mm-hmm. 2 and 4 are quite serious, and 1 and 3 are not that serious. And nowadays, what we are getting the dengue fever, they are from 1 and 3 strains. They are less serious. Thrombocytopenia is also less in these cases. And moreover, the life-threatening dengue fever, that is dengue shock syndrome and dengue hemorrhagic fever, they are less likely with these strains. Although it is epidemiologically, it is a very significant illness, it takes a lot of toll. But as far as the case fatality is concerned or as far as the mortality is concerned, any day it is less than 0.5%. And as far as the cases are concerned, I think lot many cases are happening. Some of them going unreported also, because many of the dengue fever, they behave like normal viral fever. Hmm. They get little fever, little rash, and maybe little thrombocytopenia, and they go away after 5 to 7 days without leaving any effect on the impact on the individual. So a lot of cases are going undetected also.
Hmm.
So it is a serious problem. And with the coming up of November month, because this mosquito Aedes aegypti, it doesn't survive in a temperature which is less than 16 degrees. Hmm. So with the changing of the temperature, this illness goes away. But you are right, it is a major problem,
hmm,
which takes a lot of hours of manpower. And at times it is life-threatening and it kills also.
Hmm. All right. So, Dr. Mishra, now this kind of fever,
we must understand the general symptoms of viral fever are getting headache, fever, sudden onset of high-grade fever with retrobulbar pain, maybe little irritation in the throat and runny nose. These are the normal features of a simple viral fever. But in dengue fever, there are 2-3 features which are there, like the appearance of a rash, erythematous rash. If it is there, we can suspect clinically that probably we are dealing with a dengue fever. Second, it is also called bone-breaking fever or dandy fever. There is a lot of pain, body aches are there. The patient will feel as if someone is breaking the bones inside. So that is why it is named as bone breaking fever or dengue fever. So these are two symptoms which are alarming. We can say that maybe this patient is suffering from dengue fever. Low grade fevers, they are never a feature of dengue fever. It is a high grade fever which occurs in dengue fever. Besides that, there are certain alarming things which will never occur in a viral fever.
Mm-hmm.
Like
mm-hmm.
if the patient is getting bleeding, maybe hemoptysis, that is bleeding from the with the cough, or hematemesis, bleeding from the gastrointestinal tract, or bleeding from rectal area, or bleeding all over the skin, what we call as petechial rashes. So these are all additional features which are not going to occur in a normal viral fever. So
mm-hmm.
this is how we can distinguish between. But the carry home message is that any fever which has rash and which has bad body pains,
hmm,
we must suspect for dengue.
Hmm. Right. So else that you would want to undertake?
In one line I can tell you, there are only 3 tests which needs to be done. Number 1 is the serology.
Hmm.
Number 2 is platelet count, and number 3 is PCV. We don't need any other test to be done for
hmm.
dengue hemorrhagic, for dengue fever
hmm.
of any kind. There are
hmm.
3 varieties: classical dengue, dengue hemorrhagic, and dengue shock syndrome. So we
hmm.
don't need to do any complicated test. Unless the patient comes in shock, then we need to see the liver function and kidney functions and coagulogram and other things. But by and large speaking, we need only these 3 things.
Hmm. So which
now
means a blood test.
Yeah,
right.
Blood test.
Right.
And they are very simple tests. And one thing I will again like to tell you, that clinical examination is very important. By doing a clinical examination, almost we can reach to the accuracy of almost 90% whether we are dealing with dengue fever or not. And then these tests, they are going to support us for that. One more thing I will like to tell you is that there is a lot of panic as far as the platelet counts are concerned.
Mm.
Platelet count is not a thing which is going to kill the patient. What we are concerned is about the capillary leak. That is the thing which is going to have a mortality later on. So by and large, platelets, so long as they are above 20,000 and more so they are above 10,000, we are not that much concerned. So by and large, we need only these 3 tests to be done along with a good clinical backup. Clinical backup means a properly taken history and a properly examined patient. Here I would like to tell you that in case the patient is getting more sick, then we need to admit the patient and do a lot of other tests.
Hmm.
And the patients must know that there are certain warning symptoms or warning signs. Whenever your patient has been diagnosed with dengue fever, you should remember, anytime he is having bad abdominal pain, vomiting, retching, or the patient is getting blue nails or blue lips, or at any time the patient is having a fall in BP or is having alteration of sensorium, getting unconscious, or getting any kind of bleeding from any orifice of the body, maybe through urine, through stool or this thing. So they should be careful on that and they should immediately report to the emergency. So by and large, only these three tests are required. They are available everywhere. And especially PCV and platelet count, they are very simple, non-expensive, and they can tell us quickly whether we are dealing with the dengue hemorrhagic or dengue shock syndrome.
Now,
as a clinician, I would like to tell you, hardly 0.5% of the patients of dengue will require admission, and there are only very few patients who require admission. Number one, if they are getting severe thrombocytopenia, or they are getting dengue shock syndrome type of this thing where there is tachycardia, there is hypotension, low blood pressure. And otherwise, if the patient is eating well, if the patient is well hydrated, and even if the platelet counts are as low as 60,000, 70,000, there is absolutely no need for us to admit the patient. Maybe the patient can go on daily basis and get the test or the clinical examination done. But by and large, admission requiring in a case of dengue fever, the proportion of patients is very, very, very less.
Yes, I agree.
How long does it take for a simple dengue to subside? I mean, how long till this person is absolutely fine?
I will like to give some carry-home messages as far as the treatment is concerned. By and large, dengue is a very simple illness. More than 95% of the cases, the dengue goes away without any complication of any kind. So, domiciliary treatment, that is treating at home, is a better preferred method. The only treatment which is required is paracetamol, just to lower the temperature, or the patient can do some tepid sponging. Here I will like to give one message that aspirins and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents and antibiotics, they are not at all required. Rather, they can be dangerous, they can eat up the platelets, and they can cause thrombocytopenia on their own. So what the patient requires is only a medicine for fever, that is paracetamol, maybe tepid sponging, and the patient should take a lot of liquids, liquids of any kind, maybe lassi, kanji, whatever. But the patient should take a lot of liquids so that the patient doesn't go in for dengue shock syndrome, which is a more dreaded rather than a thrombocytopenia. So by and large, the treatment what is required is domiciliary, the patient should take rest, and the patient should take all the precautions. Prevention, both the doctors have said very rightly. And if I again emphasize it, there are three areas. Number one, breeding places should go away. Number two, mosquitoes should not bite us because it is the only pivot which is going to transmit the disease. So those precautions. And number three, which is very important, killing the mosquito itself. So by fogging or by pyrethrin, and there are so many things available. So if the mosquito is not biting, so if you have any patient of dengue, you must surveillance, you must do surveillance of all your surroundings. Where is the larva? Because larva and the mosquitoes must be there. So again, they will bite any other family member and he can have dengue fever. So all the family members should be very, very careful. So prevention at the stage where the dengue patient is there, that is also very important. So they should keep themselves covered and they should take all the precautions which we have rightly discussed. There are only few warning signs where the patient needs admission. By and large, admission in the hospital is not required. So if these type of complications, they occur, the patient should be taken to the hospital. But by and large, only domiciliary treatment is what is required, and no counter drugs, and no kind of, except for paracetamol, no drug. There is no antiviral drug available for dengue fever. So the patient needs to take only a simple paracetamol, take rest, and take a lot of liquids. That is all what is required. And by and large, it is a very simple disease. And even if the patient gets dengue shock syndrome or dengue hemorrhagic fever, we can admit the patient in intensive care, and even the treatments are available for that. We can combat shock, and by and large, within a period of 7 to 10 days, most of the patients, they will get well, and within 7 days. And itching is one thing. If the patient starts itching on 5th or 6th or 7th day, we can be assured that probably now the dengue fever has gone and the patient is in the recovery phase. And by and large, after the hospitalization, we require only two things. Number one, to maintain the platelet count, and number two, to maintain the BP. These are the only two parameters which we need to maintain till the viremia goes away with a total of 7 days. And by and large, it goes away in 7 days without any complication.
Right. So I think the doctors here have been able to tell us the truth here.
Look, I will like to tell you there are a lot of myths which are going on. People say that you give papita, then the platelets will rise, or you give nariyal pani and the papita. And especially bakri ka doodh, you will be surprised that bakri ka doodh has gone up to 500 rupees per liter, because people are now asking for this milk because it is supposed to increase the platelet count. But according to the studies, by and large, there is no such food material, because platelets are, they are one of the cells of the blood, and they are manufactured in the bone marrow, and no eatable material is likely to increase the count. But the only thing, only precaution what we can tell to the scared patients is that they should take lot of liquids, and these liquids, if they are taking, then the patient will not go in for the complications of dengue fever, and they can take, as there is no dietary restriction and there is no dietary recommendation as far as the dengue fever is concerned. They can have anything, and there is no restriction in the diet. And moreover, I will like to add up that there is a lot of dengue scare. By and large, dengue is nowadays, which is coming, is from a serotypes of arboviruses, which are not very aggressive. And a lot of patients are not going in for dengue shock syndrome, which was happening previously. So we should take dengue as a normal viral. We should not scare. And of course, the message is, it is a potentially life-threatening illness. So we should always be in touch with our physicians or pediatricians. But there is nothing to be scared about it, and there is no recommended dietary restrictions or dietary enhancement which is required in these patients. Doctors and the patients, they are likely to have a tubular vision. They are always looking out for dengue in the patient. So it is quite likely, and this does happen, that all the other illnesses which cause thrombocytopenia, that is decrease in the platelet count, they are generally ignored, and all other fevers like typhoid, malaria and other disease entities which are otherwise happening in the community, they are also being ignored a little, because everyone is looking out for the dengue only. So this should be taken care by the, not only by the doctor.
Now, since
prevention is better than cure, so you should take care of all the mosquito breeding places and take care of the disease itself. And the disease is very simple, and if the mosquito doesn't bite you, you are not going to get it. So be careful on the preventive aspect of it.
Right.